कंफर्म डायमेंशन, दीज आर इंटरव्यू क्वेश्चंस, दिस कंफर्म डायमेंशन एंड व्हाट इज अ सरोगेट की, हाउ विल यू मेंटेन सरोगेट की इन द वेयर हाउस। कंफर्म डायमेंशन इज सपोज एसटरडे वी डिस्कस इन स्टार स्कीमा वी हैव अ फैक्ट टेबल दैट इज सेंट्रली लोकेटेड एंड एसोसिएटेड विद एन नंबर ऑफ डायमेंशन टेबल्स, ऑल द डायमेंशन टेबल्स आर डायरेक्टली जॉइंड टू द फैक्ट टेबल। If a dimension table is present more than in one fact table, then the dimension table we call it as conformal dimension. This is a conformal dimension. It will exist in more than one fact table or more than in one star schema. The best example is each star schema contains a time dimension. Right? We can't compare anything without time, so we need to compulsory have the time dimension in all star schemas. So it will exist more than one star schema. So this is the best example for the conformal dimension. And the other ones are products. They will exist more than in one star schema.
Okay.
Customers, products, customers, regions.
Yeah.
The next one is surrogate key. No, I'll take an example. Suppose I started my business as an organization 10 years back. At the time, I'm using a front-end application to store my employee details. Further, I'm using SQL Server as database. In that, the employee table is employee name, employee ID, designation, cell, like this. In this, the employee ID is the primary key. I have 100 employees. The employee IDs are 1 to 100.
Okay.
Then I move to some other new application. In this also, they are maintaining the same employee table, and the ID starts with 1 1. And here I have 1 to 1,000 employees. Now, as a data warehouse data model, I need to create the dimension table of employee, right?
Yeah.
And as per the dimension table property, I need to give the primary key.
Yes.
On which column you are going to give the primary key in the data warehouse employee table?
Employee ID.
Employee ID. Okay. I gave the primary key on the employee ID. Then I started my data loading. First I'll start with the SQL Server. There are only 1 to 100 employee IDs. Here employee ID is the primary key. Here also employee ID is the primary key. 1 to 100 without any error, it will load data. Once it comes to Oracle, it has 1 to 1,000. When I try to load again employee ID 1, it's already there in the data warehouse employee table with employee ID 1. And primary key is defined on the employee ID. Will it load the first 100 records?
No.
No, right? It will say that primary key violation error. So you will lose first 100 records.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So there is a chance of losing the data.
Yes.
So to prevent this one, to prevent the loss of this data, what they will do is they won't give primary keys. Suppose in the source, in the employee table, the primary key is an employee ID. The same primary key they won't apply on the same column in the warehouse.
Okay.
They'll create a new column for each table. And they'll call that column as row underscore weight. For that row underscore weight, they don't generate the primary key values from the source. They'll generate a sequential numbers. In
okay.
The database, we have the sequence generator, right? You can use start range and start range and end range. Based on that, it will automatically generate the numbers sequentially. Suppose
okay.
If I create a new column and I give primary key on the row bit column, first it will load the 1 to 100 records, and in the row bit column the system will generate 1 to 100 numbers.
Mm-hmm.
Now it will come to here, again it will load this 1 to 1,000, and on the row bit column for this Oracle database the number starts 101 to 1,100.
Okay, like what if the first 100 same employees are present in both tables?
Maybe they store the data like that. They used 10 years back and they kept the database like that. But they want right now, they want to load the data.
Okay.
As a data warehouse, I need to keep current and history of the data, right?
No, actually, like my question was, for example, let us take a current database where 100 employees. Okay,
yes.
Like the Oracle database has 100 employees plus another 100 employees. Like the same 100 employees details plus another 100 employees.
Yes.
So basically, actually we are supposed to have only 200 records, right, in data warehouse. Like if you take like unique employee IDs, so in which like
yeah,
example, if
yeah,
sequence, you will have
yeah, you are right, but the sequence server database has different attributes for that employee IDs. Those are old employees. They have different attributes for the values.
Okay.
And
okay.
While loading data into the warehouse, I'll create a flag, whether it is a old one or new one, or it is a active or a deactivated one.
Okay, maybe like from this database or from this database, yeah.
Yes, yes, like that.
Okay. Okay.
For this database, I'll create a data source number. For this one, I'll create a data source number.
Okay, that's correct, yeah.
Okay. So to prevent the loss of data, I'll create my own column and I'll assign primary key for that column. I'll call that robot column as the surrogate key. I can simply say that it's a substitute for the primary key.
Okay.
In the data warehouse, I call that employee ID, that is the primary key in the source. Here I call it as natural key. The robot I'll call it as surrogate key.
Okay.
Just to prevent the loss of data, we use the surrogate keys.
Okay.
There is a chance, it's not compulsory for each table you lose the data, there is a chance to prevent that, we use the surrogate key concept. Can you read this one just in this part, just to understand this?
Okay.
Informatica, using a ETL tool, we load Rovit. I'll show you already.
What is it? Rovia.
See, this is the sequence generator transformation in Informatica. It will generate numbers. This is the start value. This is the end value. See, for this next value, I'm not getting the data from source. There is no input. Suppose if a record is coming from source and loading it, it will generate a number. Department number is the primary key here, but I am creating a new column and I am assigning the primary key to this new column. This column I call it as surrogate key. For this column, I am generating numbers using the sequence generator. For each record that is coming from source, it will generate a new number. It doesn't care about whether that record already there in the target or not. Just if a record is coming and it is loading into target, it will generate a new number. Next, there is another concept called ODS, Operational Data Source. Right now, for what purpose we are creating the reports? To satisfy the reporting requirement of the top level management or the mid level management. They are the persons who is responsible to take the decisions, and the decisions will impact on the business of the organization, right?
Yes.
And there are some cases the low-level people also require some reports to satisfy their daily day-to-day operations. If the client wants the operational reports, then we'll create another database called operational data store before the data warehouse. Why we create this operational data store is, for this operational data store, the data is coming from multiple systems. And we are not doing any like data warehouse concepts. Justly, we'll load data, extracting from multiple databases, and load it into the operational data store. The low level people will connect to this operational data store and they'll generate their reports. not up to date. It has the very recent data, max 3 months of data.
Okay.
Suppose there is online transaction. You are doing some shopping. Whenever you raise an order, and then that day the order will start. And you need to follow up with the customer care, right?
Yeah.
What is the status of my order? Max the order will close in either 10 days, or if you revert back, it may take 1 month or 2 months. Then the order, if you acknowledge that I received the order without any damage, then the order will close. For that reporting, they'll use this operational data store to satisfy the reporting requirement of the low-level people.
Okay.
This is an optional component. If the requirement asks about operational reports, we'll do this. The architecture will be like this. The report tool will connect to the operational data store, and based on this operational data store, they will generate some operational reports.
Oh, okay. So
instead of connecting to data warehouse, those reports directly will connect to this operational data store.
Yeah, understood. So we will be connecting a BI tool to operational data store also.
Yes.
In other words, I mean reporting tool.
Yeah, reporting tool.
Okay.
This is an optional component.
Yes, yes.
You are saying ETL, that means that you are extracting data from multiple sources. What are the different types of extraction process? Whenever you go to any data warehouse project, always we hear that did we finish loading of data or not. So if you finish loading only, you will see the latest data on the report. So as a reporting person, you need to ask the ETL people whether that loading is done or not. So in that loading, there are four different types of loading data from source to target. First one we call it as initial extract. Initial extract, or in normal terms we call it as full load. You created the data model, you created tables in a relationship wall. Using the ETL tool, you created some jobs to extract data from here to here. Whenever you put this architecture in the production, you need to start loading data, right, from source.
Yes.
The first time that you are loading data from source to data warehouse is called the full load or initial extract. Initially, you are extracting data from source to warehouse. That is called initial extract or full load. In the full load, the client will specify from which period you need to start the loading of data. So I have business from 10 years, but I don't care about the previous data. I care about only the, I want to store only last 5 years of data in the data warehouse, starting from last 5 years. So initially I will load the entire data from the last 5 years to till date. That load we call it as full load. Delta extract. Delta extract in the sense, you already did the full load. As a customer, you did a change in the source level. You go to bank and you said, I want to change my address. They'll change. That means that they'll update your address. Right?
Yep.
So, but in the warehouse, you already the data is loaded in the warehouse. You have the old address.
That's correct.
So you need to, but in the report, it will show the old address. But you need to refresh the source with target, right, with data warehouse. So
yes.
If it is a delta extract, it will identify the changes. In the source, it has a different address, but in the warehouse, it has a different address. It will take the source latest address. It will go and update the warehouse address. That is called delta extract. Inserts will be inserts, updates will be updates. So if you add a customer in the source, it will take that record and insert that record in the warehouse. If you did a update in the source, it take that change and update the same in the warehouse. That is called delta extract. Delta is nothing but change. Whenever a change happens in the source, just you reflect that change in the warehouse.
Okay.
Next thing is incremental extract. Incremental in the sense, today you did the full load. My load frequency is every day 12 p.m. and
Raghu,
it's
Raghu, I have a question.
Yeah.
Raghu, Raghu, I have a question, sorry. So,
yeah.
Delta extract, you said that whenever there are the changes, the new records are added, it will be added, reflected to the data warehouse from the source.
Yes.
So, how does this change is recognized? I mean, will there be system set parameters or what do you mean exactly the changes will be reflected by that?
Using ETL tool, we have some mechanism.
Okay.
Whenever I start loading data, first I'll compare the data with the data warehouse table.
Mm-hmm.
First I'll compare, suppose in source I have 10 customers,
mm-hmm.
but in my warehouse I have only 9 customers.
Right.
I'll compare this customer ID with that customer ID. If that customer ID exists, that means that he is a existing customer. If whatever the customer ID is there in the source, but that's not there in the target, that means that he is the new customer. So I'll trigger the mechanism, go and insert the new customer in the warehouse.
So in other words, a transformation algorithm.
Yes.
Okay.
And I'll check source with target and I'll trigger the commands whether it needs to insert or it needs to update.
Okay, okay.
It's an ETL mechanism. As a reporting tool, you don't do it.
Right.
Next one is incremental extract. Suppose today I did the load, full load. Daily you are not going to load the last 5 years, since from the last 5 weeks of data, right? So if you do that, the performance will go down. What you will do is, first you do the full load. Today I did the full load. Tomorrow, just I will load this 24 hours gap data. Today to tomorrow. Already I have the data since from the last 5 years. Today I did. Tomorrow I will just load the last 24 hours of data. Day after tomorrow I will load that 24 hours of data. That is that kind of loading we call it as incremental extract. A refresh strategy. We follow this kind of loading refresh strategy for the ODS, operational data store. What we'll do is we'll truncate, as we said that it maintains very less amount of data, max 90 days of data. To load data into operational data store, first we'll truncate all the data. I'll take the last 3 months of data from source and put it there. That's it.
Okay, like basically removing the old data and adding the new data.
Yes, placing the new data, not adding, just remove and place.
Yeah.
Every time when a new set of data is extracted from OLTP system, the existing data in the ODS is truncated, incoming data is loaded as the fresh data. We don't follow any rules and nothing, just replace the refresh data.
The existing data is deleted, right? Not truncated.
Yeah, both are same, we'll truncate it.
Okay.
What are the different types of fact table? Now we'll see different types of fact tables and different types of dimension tables. As a reporting, you don't require this one, but just to understand the concept.
Okay, actually it's good to know, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
In the fact table, what kind of data we have? We have the detailed level of transactions. Suppose if a customer did 10 transactions, I'll maintain 10 records for that customer. There are four types of fact tables: periodic snapshot fact table, accumulating snapshot fact table, transaction gain, and factless fact table. What is a periodic snapshot fact table? But all the tables we call it as fact. By seeing the type of data they are storing, we can say that this is a periodic snapshot fact table, or this is an accumulating snapshot fact table. If you see the credit card bill, the statement, you, on the top you have one summary line, in below you have all the transactions. Right? It's a snapshot for the last month transactions, right?
Yeah, that's correct.
You can't change that snapshot. If you take a snap, you can't change. You'll keep there for that month.
Yes.
And the, it is saying, it's a periodically you'll take the snapshot. It's a monthly period and that is a snapshot. I'll place that data.
Okay.
If you maintain that kind of data, we call it as a periodic snapshot fact table. See, he's saying extraction of the data has to be done based on the business user's requirement. It is credit card bill, that's why it is a monthly one. Suppose some customers have, some organizations have different requirement. They want to take weekly snapshot for their sales.
Okay.
So according to user's requirement, we will decide the period.
Okay.
Data is loaded from the OLTP tables into OLAP on a periodic basis. Only inserts are permitted in the periodic snapshot fact table. See, if you see the credit card also, suppose you have a petrol surcharge bill or something. At the time of doing transaction, they will charge 50 rupees extra. But they don't update the already existing transaction. If they want to deposit that 50 rupees again into account, they will create a new record and they will say that created CR.
Yeah, that's correct.
So only inserts are permitted in periodic snapshot fact tables. No updations, nothing. They'll take a snapshot from the source, insert it, that's it. Now, accumulating snapshot fact table. Now, what is the meaning of this accumulating?
Raghu.
Yeah.
Raghu.
Yeah, go ahead.
So the periodic will have only periodic amount of data or the complete data?
On that period, what are the data is there, all the data will be available.
So only for that period, if a period is defined as a 1 month, only 1 month data will be available.
1 month data, 1 month data for all my customers in my organization.
Right, right.
Suppose if a customer can do 10 transactions, I'll maintain all the transactions. If a customer can do 30 transactions, I'll maintain all the transactions of that customer for that month.
I think, Satya, it's just a matter of how periodic you want to take the extract, not how much data you have it in the system.
That's what I am. My question was, that's what, yeah. So it's a periodic, during that period only data, that is why it is periodic, okay?
Yeah. For this accumulating snapshot fact table, the best example is ordering some product in a online store. Mm-hmm. Suppose in the periodic snapshot you are doing only insert. Suppose if you order something in the online store, they'll create an order on your account. They'll generate some customer number for you and they'll create an order for you with the product name, product number and the price, quantity and your address and all. Will that order close on that day itself? No, right? No. I need to deliver the product to you. And you need to acknowledge, you need to sign them, I received with any without any damage. Then they need to update that order that completed.
Yes.
Or closed, they need to specify. Then only the order transaction will close. Mm-hmm. Order is a fact table. So accumulating snapshot fact table in the sense, it has the different starting period and different ending period. When did this order open? When did this order close? So okay. That's what he's saying. Information in the accumulating snapshot fact table has a different starting and ending period. The complete information is not loaded at the time of initial loading the data. Today, yesterday you opened the order. Yesterday night I loaded data from source to warehouse.
Okay.
At the time of loading your order, I don't have the complete information whether that order is closed or not. That's what he's trying to say.
Okay. So what
in
your order record?
Come again?
No, once the order is completed, when you like before you load the data into warehouse next day, if the order is completed, you're going to update that the order is completed.
Yeah, we have a status column. You order, by default the status column will be open, the order is open. Whenever you acknowledge that, then I'll go and update as close.
Okay.
In the report, they want to see only open orders. Based on that status column, they'll view the filter condition. Just in the drop-down, they'll select only open. It will go and fire a query on the database warehouse. It will get all the open orders and show it in the report.
Okay.
So both inserts and updates are permitted here. You need to update the status of your order, right?
Yes.
The information is added to the accumulating snapshot fact table only when the events occur. So when a delivery happened, you will get an acknowledge. Then only when an event occur only, you will do the changes to the warehouse data.
Okay.
Or information added to the accumulating snapshot fact table.
Okay.
No. Here you need to understand what is a granularity. Granularity in the sense the amount of data that you want to see, right? My granularity level is year wise, monthly wise, weekly wise. In the source, I store all the transaction details, right?
Yes.
If you want to maintain the same level of transactions in the warehouse for the fact table, then that fact table will be called as transaction grain fact table.
Okay.
In the data warehouse, sometimes you say that you will add data that is coming from source, submit up for a month or weekly, you load the summary of the data in the warehouse. But there are cases that if in the source table you have 1 lakh records, you want to store all 1 lakh records, detailed level of data in the fact table in the warehouse. You want to maintain same level of detail of data both in source and target, then that kind of fact table we call it as the transaction grain fact table. The same level of granularity will maintain as transactions.
Okay.
When same level of detail of transaction data is maintained in the fact table of OLAP system, such tables are treated as transaction grain.
Okay.
In the data warehouse also, you have the same level of detail as like source.
Okay.
There is no summary, there is no average, there is no snapshot like that.
Okay.
The next thing is factless fact table. The name itself is saying there is a fact table without a fact. As per fact table structure, you have the facts section, measure section, as well as the key section. Key section in the sense, you have the foreign key section. Suppose in a fact table or is associated with 5-dimension tables, you will have 5-dimension tables foreign keys, right?
Yes.
Remaining columns are quantity, amount. So I have a fact table only foreign keys. There are no quantity, amount. That kind of fact table we call it as factless fact table.
Okay.
By seeing the data of the fact table, you think that it may be accumulating or it may be transaction grain fact table or it may be periodic snapshot.
Okay, any example?
But fact table is nothing but there should be some fact, right? That's what you said.
The definition
of the fact table is nothing but we must have any numerical value or something like that, aggregate function or something. In other words, there needs to be a fact.
Yeah, if they want to join some of the dimensions, one star schema to other star schema, they need to have some bridge connection.
Usually we build a star schema with, for example, 5-dimension table, 1 fact table.
Yes.
Okay. So this factless fact table is a fact table in my star schema? No, right?
Yes, it's factable in your star schema.
How? Without any aggregate values also? without any quantity.
Actually, why they use this fact-less effectively is to establish connection between the two star schemas.
Ah, yeah, okay.
It's
okay.
not for the reporting.
Oh, that was what you were saying, something like join. You started, you were talking some join.
Yes.
Like, can you give any example, Raghu? Like,
I actually didn't use this fact-less fact table, but as per theory, they're saying like this.
Okay, that's all right. Okay.
But anyway, there is no fact, Raghu, you don't need to use. Fine, go ahead.
Yeah, the next thing is types of dimension table. They are classified into three dimension tables. The first thing is time dimension. For this time dimension, you don't require any source, right? Suppose they'll maintain all the data related to time. Suppose for this 2013 year, they'll maintain month-wise, week-wise, day-wise, hourly-wise. They'll maintain the data like this. To generate the time dimension, they'll write a stored procedure. They'll use the starting year and ending year. Within that year, it will generate all. For each day in a year, you have all the information. What is the day number in month? Calendar week number, week ending day. Suppose your transaction happened in this date, 1/1/1998. Now you want to get the data for a particular week of that month. So you need to have the weekend date for this transaction date, right? So you have the weekend date here.
Okay, so these things, we don't have to create any tables. Anyway, system will have all this information by itself.
Yeah, system will have, or they'll write a stored procedure, the DBS. They'll give the starting and ending. They have their own stored procedures. This
but
doesn't require a separate... Yeah,
sorry.
Right.
Usually this should be a system table, right? Something like...
Whenever you create a new schema, you won't get these tables.
Oh, okay.
Normally they will write stored procedure to generate the day dimension. And you have the month name and everything you have. What is the fiscal month, calendar month? Suppose a transaction happened on the day, particular day, you need to, you have the fact to time dimension, you have a direct join. So you take the transaction date from the fact table, you will match here, and you can get the relevant information from these remaining columns. This is about one of the dimensions of the star schema should always be a time dimension. Next one is tiny dimension. Tiny, the name itself is saying it's a small dimension. Suppose I have a dimension, gender dimension. You know the values of the gender. There will be only two columns and there will be only two records. To generate a gender dimension, you don't require a separate ETL process, right? Informatica job, or you can directly create a table gender. You can hard code the values. That kind of dimensions, very small dimensions, we call it as tiny dimensions.
Okay.
A dimension table with less number of columns and less number of records, whereas a separate ETL process is not required for loading data.
Okay.
Now, the next thing is regular dimensions. This one is very important. It's a definite question if you go any entry, 99%. Again, the regular dimensions are classified into three types. Slowly changing dimensions. The name itself is saying you can apply this slowly changing concept only on the dimensions table. What are the possible dimensions we have? Products, customers, regions. Mm-hmm. Suppose I'll take customer table as an example. At the time of joining, at the time of joining in my organization, he gave the city as Boston. So I loaded the same data in the warehouse, but after some time he changed his a location from Boston to New York, how you want to maintain this change of the dimension in the warehouse? That is the concept of slowly changing dimensions. If a dimension attribute is changing in the source, how do you want to maintain that change in the warehouse? That is the concept. Each organization has its own requirements. Suppose some organization don't care about the customer's previous location. They always do business with the current location. But some customers are particularly about to maintain all the history of the customer. In the warehouse, they want to maintain right now at the time of joining where is his current location and right now where is the current location.
Can you give an example for slowly changing dimension?
Yeah, we have examples for all the three. Can you read this one just? It's an example. And after that, we'll go in detail one by one. Again, the slowly changing dimensions are categorized into three types. Slowly changing dimension type 1. Suppose my customer requirement is he doesn't want to maintain any history of the customers where he lived in the past. Just he's more about what is his current location. So whenever a customer changes his address, that means that updated his address, just do the same in the warehouse. Go and update the address in the warehouse also. That is the type 1 dimension. In the type 1 slowly changing dimension, the new information simply overrides the original information. So if you override the original information, you don't trace the previous address, right? That is what he is saying. See?
Okay.
Previously, his state is Illinois, then in the source, he changed it to California. I did the same updation, I removed the Illinois and updated with California.
Okay.
So, I don't know whether this customer may previously lived in Illinois. I know that his current address is only California. What are the advantages and disadvantages of using the type 1? Advantage is this is very easy, just you'll fire an update.
Okay.
Disadvantage is you don't have the history, that's it. When you choose type 1 to implement, type 1 slowly changing dimension should be used when it is not necessary for the data warehouse to keep track of historical changes. If you don't want to maintain history of the dimension, I'll go for the type 1. No. Type 2. In the type 2, the customer wants to maintain both current and history of the data. The same example, Illinois, he moved to California. This way, I'll maintain the data in the warehouse.
Okay.
This customer key is my surrogate key.
Okay.
Same name, Illinois and California. Now, you'll get a doubt. I have data, two records for the same customer. How can I identify which is the latest one and which is the oldest one?
The record with highest surrogate key?
No, we'll maintain some other columns. See, like this. For this accounting department, the location is Goa, and it has two locations, Goa and Mumbai. I will maintain a version number. I will take the max of version number, that will be the current one.
Okay.
For type 2, I will maintain the version number like this.
Okay.
Okay. Now, advantages and disadvantages. Whenever there is a.
That's a system built, or we design those version numbers, Raghu? It's a system built, or our defined columns?
Our defined columns, version numbers.
Oh, okay.
I'll write the mechanism in the ETL tool.
Okay, so we need to know what is the slowly changing dimension. Basically, we need to define before, we need to design, in other words, before only we need.
First, what we do is, at the time of data modeling, we'll get the requirements from the client. So suppose whether on this dimension table, what type he wants, what kind of data that he wants to maintain in the warehouse. Suppose if it is a type 2, after creating the table, I'll add these extra columns, version number and all. If it is a type 1, there is no need of the version number, right?
Yeah, that's what I said. So based, you need to design this, in the design session only we'll come to know what is the type of data. Based on that, tables will be automatically designed.
Okay. Yeah, once it is a type 2, I'll write my own mechanism in the ETL to populate those extra columns.
Right. Okay.
Now, if you use type 2, whenever there is a change happen, you need to insert a new record with that change. See, here in the state, there is a change update happen. With that update, what I did, I inserted a new record.
Okay.
Right? So, if a customer changes his address in the source 10 times, we'll have 10 records in the target with the same customer details.
Yes.
So the size of the database will increase, right? That is the disadvantage. Advantage is you can keep track of all the history of the customer. That is the advantage. So okay. If the size increases the database, the performance will go down, right?
Yes.
Those are the disadvantages. Now, type 3. In type 3, how we will maintain the data is, and the customer doesn't bother about all the history of the customer. He wants only what is his current address, what is his previous address. He wants to maintain only those two information. Suppose if he changed 10 times after joining my organization, he doesn't care. Where is he now and what is his previous address? Only he wants to maintain only those two.
Okay.
We'll create an extra column. Suppose I'm bothered about state column. So for state column, I created two columns in the warehouse for the state column. This is the source table. In the warehouse, I'll create for state column like this, current state and original state.
Okay.
He changed in the source, he changed from Illinois to California. So I'll maintain the data like this. Current state is California, original state is Illinois. Suppose again from California to he changed to Boston, after loading data, the data will be, current state will be Boston, the original state will be California. The Illinois gone in the gone from the warehouse.
Okay.
So in this, the advantage is there is no separate insert. We are updating the current customer record only. So there is no increase in the size. But the disadvantage is you don't have the complete history of the customer. You have only limit some extent of the history. That is the disadvantage.
Okay.
All this mechanism will be written in the ETL. Just in interview, did you implement SCVs? What are the different types of SCV types? Is this clear? Slowly changing dimensions.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is clear, Raghu, but seriously, I didn't understand. I know you said it is a very, very important 99% question, but I'm so. What is this? It's just a change of data, right? Why it is? What is the significance so for the so importance? It's a change of data, basically maintaining your history record, whatever, whatever, in three different types. Either
yes.
you keep the current record, or you keep the old and current with limited information, or you keep everything together, including history.
Concept wise, it is important in data warehouse. Architecture wise, who invented these architectures? And these are also not required. It's a old one, just we. There are two guys, Inman and Willman, those invented the architectures. Like how the data warehouse should be, what are the components should be there in the warehouse. And we categorize these approaches as top-down approach and bottom-down approach. Bill Inman suggested that top-down approach. Suppose if you want to build a data warehouse for an organization, first you need to understand data flow in all the source systems and build a data warehouse on all the subject areas. Study all the subject areas, build a data model for all subject areas, then do the reporting. That is the top-down approach. You'll build on top of all the subject areas the data model. Then you, whenever you want a report, you'll fire a query on the data warehouse, we get it. Top-down approach. Bottom-up, the Kimball architecture is bottom-up approach. Whenever there is a need, they'll create a star schema, they'll straight away do the report. They can't wait for the next subject area to build. That is the bottom-up approach.
Okay.
Maybe in interest, there may be a chance of what is a top-down approach, what is the bottom-up. This is the top-down approach. See, yesterday we discussed data mart, right? First, I'll integrate all the subject areas in a data warehouse. Then, I'll divide and rule as you said yesterday.
Okay.
Yes.
It's a subset of the data warehouse, the data mart. First, I'll do a data warehouse for all subject areas. Then, I'll divide top-down. Here, bottom-up. First, they'll create a data mart and they'll integrate all the data mart and they'll say this is the data warehouse.
Okay.
And what are the advantages and disadvantages for top down approach as well as the bottom up approach? First, we'll explain the what are the different components available in OBI 11G.
Okay.
Then we'll start with the first one. How will we create the RPD, that physical layer, BMM layer, logical layer?
Okay.
And what are the different properties are there in that creation of RPD?
Okay.
Once we create a simple RPD, then we'll go to the report tool. We'll do the reportings like creating charts, bars, and ascending aggregation tools. Drill downs, drill ups in the report. If we want to do a report, first we need to create the RPD, the model, right? So we'll start with the RPD thing first.
Okay.
Sure.
RPD is nothing but repository place directory.
Right.
Okay.